Ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to the TI5 American Qualifiers. We are here in the Losers Bracket Finals with Narvi versus mousesports, our second game of the series. It is a best of three. And Narvi, right now, they're facing elimination. We are going to jump right into the draft here. Joining me alongside is going to be Merlini. We've got Hani as well as Purge. Guys, we're already into the draft. Game number one was a goddamn disaster for Narvi, I'd go as far as to say. Game number two, let's hope the draft's a bit better for them.
It is completely different than every other draft I've seen Narvi do. They almost always lead off with supports, especially a Dazzle, if they have the option. But this game, they're completely changing it up, and I think it's YOLO time.
It is YOLO time. I like the Bristleback pick. What do you guys think, Hani?
I think the opening is very strong. Having Bristleback plus Witch Doctor, you're still very open to where you choose to put those heroes. But it gives you a lot of physical damage. Witch Doctor, always a pretty good support. I think the opening is very strong here for Nor.
I agree. IO Shadow Demon, an interesting start for mousesports as well. Any thoughts on the start of the draft, Ben?
Why Shadow Demon?
He's been pretty popular lately. I mean,
but why versus these two?
And why second pick also?
I mean, I see him a fair amount, but it's usually with someone that can set up or that's someone who's really good with the images or, you know, maybe anti-mage on opposite team or something like that. Well, it's usually one or the other.
There's still Lesh in the pool, so maybe they're hoping they can get Lesh as their core in the second round. And then, they could have done a Shadow Demon Lesh dual lane because Wisp is obviously going to be somewhere else. I mean, I feel like if you have the right carry, you can get by with a Shadow Demon dual lane very easily. He's got a pretty good animation. Yeah. You know, you can zone. It's pretty defensive in case you get in a bad situation. So.
But versus a Bristleback, you won't be able to zone. They can always just throw Bristleback to the offlane, especially with like a Bristleback Witch Doctor offlane, let's say. And then it's really difficult for the Shadow Demon to do anything.
If you're 1v1, it's okay. Mm-hmm. It's not the best. But, you know, if he's still level 1, his quills are low, he's not going to have goo. It's not terrible. But, yeah, I am mostly good. Especially if it's a dual lane, he definitely can't bully well at all.
They go for the Darkseer third pick, though, coming out from North American Rejects. One of these heroes is going to be an MSS hero, and I'm inclined to believe that it's going to be Darkseer.
Yeah.
And that feels a lot better than an offline Earthshaker that doesn't do anything for the first 10-15 minutes of the game besides gets first blood.
Well, he can go jungle. And he's also they can also safelane Darkseer if they want to.
Yep.
The fabled Nyx Assassin from mousesports. I haven't seen any of their games yet where they played that.
That's his hero.
Very good versus Darkseer. Darkseer buys a lot of int items. In the late game, you can just mana burn him very easily. Bristleback, actually, another hero that really needs to have mana to be useful. If you can't cast spells, he's going to be in a bad place.
What do you think so far, Hani?
And they pick a line into that as well. I guess it's just a standard support, but I just feel like you might, when you see a Nyx Assassin and then you pick on top of that another very intelligence-heavy hero, it's questionable, but I believe they have a strat. I think going back towards the Shadow Demon, I felt like when you pick a Shadow Demon IO in that regard, I think your follow-up is usually like where you don't struggle as much. Whereas if you would pick a Leshrac, right, if that's the option where you still want to have the Shadow Demon, then you rely so much on the Shadow Demon if you wanted to have the Shadow Demon instead the other way around, right?
Right.
Yeah.
I do like the Lion pick, though, because it does protect them against heroes like Storm, as it did get picked up later. I mean, they are weak on disables, Darkseer, Bristleback. Witch Doctor has a stun, but it's a bit finicky, and you can't really lock down Chain in, reliably, at least. So Lion did protect them based on whatever mousesports would pick. I think it's just a safe support pick. Like, obviously, it has some weaknesses, but being able to Hex and do an Earth Spike, if you can initiate properly, can often win you team fights. So.
But, I mean, they're going to have a really difficult time locking down a Storm because they have a Shadow Demon on top of it. Like, if he gets Hex, defensively Shadow, Defensive Disrupt, or, like, Overcharge plus Tether.
Relocate out.
Yeah, there's so many things to counter the Lion that I think I would prefer, like, a stronger AoE hero. I guess they did ban them out with the Sand King and the Enigma, but generally I think that's a better way to approach IO and Shadow Demon.
How do you get a Shadow Fiend last pick? That is a value pickup coming out from Narvi 2. That's a hero they play literally almost, not every game, but they play it a ton for Ush, and they get it with the fifth pick. It gets all the way through. That's a pretty big deal for Narvi 2, I think, in this situation.
I like their synergy a lot. They've got Shadow Fiend minus armor. They've got Bristleback minus armor. They've got Witch Doctor ulti, so that works pretty well. Darkseer can Iron Shell on the Bristleback. He can Surge him to chase down. That's actually going to be a huge deal. A Surge Bristleback going after either a Shadow Demon or a Wisp, he's going to have to burn Demonic Purge, or Wisp is going to have to be very, very careful. I do like the synergy on NAR here, whereas for mousesports, the Shadow Demon doesn't super synergize with anything other than Storm Spirit. The Wisp isn't exactly tethering on any of these heroes very often. Maybe so can Nyx Assassin or something like that.
You can tether on Storm.
Yeah, and on Storm is pretty good, definitely, especially because you can give him mana, which allows him to do more things. But mousesports really needs their tanky up front. Who's going to be with Wisp throughout the game? Hero.
It's always Tiny.
We're going to find out. Eight seconds left. It could be Tiny. It's not banned out. That's definitely a possibility coming up from mousesports here. What are they going to grab? 3, 2, it's the Viper. They go for the Viper, which is something that obviously Narvi 2 did not have success with last game. But Viper, that is an interesting choice, guys, coming out for this last pick from mousesports.
Do you like Viper pick, Honey?
I'm not a big Viper fan, but if they make it work, I think it's pretty good with a Storm here. Mm-hmm. Overall, you get a techie core next to Storm. It's quite important. And I think for the side of Gnar here, it's the better lineup to me. It seems very solid. Physically heavy, but a lot stronger. You can make more mistakes with that lineup. So I think approaching this game towards a win for Gnar, very important that they have a stable lineup. We'll see how they make it happen. I think for the side of Mouse, it depends a lot on how much Bulba can achieve with an XSS. And I'm very skeptical on the pick, but in this qualifier, he played it a few times, I think, and he's done very well. So we'll have to watch out for that.
That is his hero. He plays that a lot, honestly. That's one of his go-to pickups in the offlane. It's either Clockwork, Nyx Assassin. Sometimes he'll play the Darkseer as well. Purge, any closing thoughts before we head right into this game?
Yeah, I like Narvi's draft a little bit better here. Like you said, I see more synergies with their lineup, the Wisp and the Shadow Demon they picked first, and then they were kind of like, how do we fit this together with the picks that also counter theirs? And I feel like they were a bit off the mark there. So, but they did play far better than Narvi did in the last game, so yeah. Could go either way.
That is definitely true. Narvi either were tilting, they just weren't having a great time in that first game. The draft may be a little bit rough. I think we are going to jump into the game. I'm not sure. We are sitting in right now, and it looks like it is going to be mousesports versus Narvi. Thank you again to Purge as well as Hani for doing some analysis into the draft. I do want to give some shout-outs here because I forgot last game. We have Pimpmunkle doing the observing, a good friend of mine. We've done Dota Pit together for a long time, as well as Knoxville on stats. So shout-out to those guys for joining us. We are going to jump into the game, Merlini, and it's going to be pretty interesting, man. We're going to see how this goes. Already an early observer war to block the camp from mousesports. And just not real too much aggression. There is going to be a lane ward for Chad as well.
Going back to the Bulba pick for Bulba's Nyx, I think he's really good at these type of heroes. The ones that he has to choose when or when not to go in, which is probably the hardest part as an initiator. Like, when he played the Beastmaster, there were no roars that were like, oh, crap. He roars himself into a bad situation and his team goes in and they get owned by like a Fissure Block or Echo right. or something, or Lina stun. Or... like, they rarely got blindsided, too, because of his summons. He was able to, just pick and choose his engages very, very well. And he knows that when he goes in, his team should win the fight if everything is executed properly. That happens when he plays Clockwork. It happens when he plays Nyx. It happens when he plays Beastmaster. And it's not necessarily the hero, I think, that is that important. It's just that the hero has to be able to initiate in some sort of manner. Like, let's say, unlike Timber or something like that.
It's possibly due to this team fight not being maybe as strong for mousesports. There's more synergy on the side of Narvi 2. And also, he doesn't really care that he's giving his life away. Maybe in this situation, he does. Wants to get off multiple impales. Maybe wants to keep himself alive, get off the mana drains as well. Earthspike from Chad coming out into Bulb with a right click just to harass. Almond the Frondillo is going to be sitting nearby, and Korok is going to be able to free farm for the most part. Way 2's getting run at in the top lane by Iron Shell from the Darkseer. MSS already doing a little bit more in this early game. Maybe not getting the first blood just yet, but at least he should have a pretty good time in this lane. I don't think he should die, but Chad is going to get the kill onto Bulba down bottom. They use the Earth Spike, and it looks like Korok just runs at him. What was Bulba doing up there? How did that happen?
I don't actually know. He has boots. He doesn't have a stout shield, which is, I think, Universe usually goes poor man shield just because it's really good on Nyx. It has a combination of his very high HP regen as well as having that poor man shield is just amazing at keeping your HP high, so you're not in death positions. Boots is good for running away from initiations, but he's just getting harassed out, right? So it would have been much better, I think, for him to start off with a stout shield this game. But again, that's not Bulba's strength. It's not necessarily winning lane. Getting those kills, getting that scouting information out for his team.
Not necessarily surviving, just making sure you stay alive. Well, stay alive, get some levels, and then go from there, get to the mid-game. Well, and
I also think that's one of Mouse's better strengths relative to Narvi, is that they're not afraid to take risks and not afraid to die when you need to. Like, the AA Rubick just played so scared all game.
Yep.
And they were just constantly scared of the ghost of the Bounty Hunter. And Bounty Hunter died a lot, and he was able to scout him out a decent amount, but they still didn't take the risk that, okay, we'll just smoke and try and avoid him this way and pick out the gyro, or smoke maybe and do bottom and kill the Beastmaster. They were just never in that sort of position, whereas you have players like Bulba and Pilot Eye who will sacrifice their lives for information, and information is power.
It's key. Yeah, information leads into the Observer Wards, leads into the Vision. You have that Vision power coming out at 14 minutes into the game. That's beautiful coming out. Meanwhile, Black Diving Ush won't get the kill. The IO overcharge coming with a tether, and they're already playing so aggressively. Seven last hits only for the Shadow Fiend. He'll be able to come back top lane. Iron Shell's going to go through. Quakefist is going to walk up. Goes for the Remnant. MSS in trouble. He's got Surge. He's going to have to use it. They can't chase him down, but they will have somebody going to the top rune spot. MSS is only level one Surge. He's in trouble. He's going to have to juke and jive his way to safety. He does have the salve, but he's going to give up a kill here. The last right click comes out from Pile I Die, and that's just MSS out of position, out of mana, and level one Surge is not enough.
That's going to be really bad for him, because I think Storm will have Vortex by the time he gets back, and then they're not going to be able to like, that takes off like 1 second of his very short duration Surge. He needs like level 2 Surge and level 2 Iron Shell to put pressure in this lane.
Yep.
And he is falling behind there.
Getting too aggressive. Bulba's still in level 2 though, so it's not looking too bleak coming out, no pun intended, for the side of the Darkseer. That's right, guys. Chad is not actually Chad. His name is Bleak. But for some reason, he insists on being called Chad, which I guess I can get behind. So he did get that first blood. 24 last hits for Korok. He's doing a great job in this lane. Let's see. Despite an early death, Bulba's skill and Nyx are not to be underestimated. 10-1 in 6.83 and 6.84. They clearly picked this hero for a reason. He knows what he's doing with it. So that's not a huge... I guess it is kind of a huge surprise. That's a really good win rate coming through on the Nyx Assassin. Arcanes! Bristleback going to be going Guardian Greaves, perhaps, coming out from Korok, which is what we saw in the last game, and we weren't a big fan of on Viper, but that might be what he's going for this game as well. Ush getting chased down mid, Black going for right click, the TP coming in, the rotation, he's actually TPing out Fog, going to throw the cask up, it's going to bounce through, bounces to a creep, Pilot Eye might get out, the Earth Spike's not there, they needed to bounce back to Pilot Eye, and it just was not available. So close.
Guardian Greaves, I mean, with mech being nerfed so much, I think Guardian Greaves in this recent iteration of 6.84 is more justified. But, I mean, we've talked enough about Guardian Greaves.
But Guardian Greaves on a Bristleback, though.
It's pretty good.
Okay. MSS in the top lane. He won't have to go for the mech. That means he's free to go for maybe an early Blink Dagger.
Why is he, like, sidestepping so much in this?
Like, I'm not sure.
I mean, you sidestep when you're scared of dodging stuff, but Nyx isn't six, and there's nothing else to dodge.
He's practicing. He's warming up for later when Nyx Assassin does eventually hit level six.
His mouse is broken.
It could be that, too. If that's the case, MSS is having one rough day. That's all I can honestly say. He's actually getting chased down. There's going to be the tether coming in. Quick that has the pull. Surge is about to come through. There's the pull, and MSS might be able to make it out. Last ball lightning. They got the shadow poison. It doesn't take the ball lightning further. The IO tether coming through, giving the mana to Koikva, plus the soul ring he uses, and that is going to be the kill coming out for that storm spirit in the top lane. MSS dies yet again, and maybe you have to think about rotating to the jungle now.
Or, like, double Ion from afar.
Yeah.
And just get gold and sacrifice your XP. At this point, it's not working out. They have a reserve reward there. Not sure if MSS knows that, but probably not.
He's TPing back top. He should play pretty far back. So they're kind of bullying him out of this lane. The thing is, though, I don't think he's ever going to get too far behind. He's level 5. The Nyx Assassin, I don't think, is up there.
He doesn't have boots. He's pretty far behind.
Well, in terms of monetization and the items he has, yes. But in terms of levels, he's doing okay. He will be able to... He could theoretically just jungle, honestly, if you wanted to. But he wants to stay top for the time being. Way 2 is going to walk back up. They don't have the IO this time through. But Storm is level 6, and we saw it's still very scary. Way 2 is just going to zone him out with right clicks alone. Still, it's really rough for MSS, at least for right now.
Yeah, it's going to be hard for him to catch up because the pressure is going to start mounting for on Narv very soon. They almost have level 6 on Wisp, almost have level 6 on Nyx Assassin, and then people are just zipping in, like flying in, relocating in, teleporting in, like left, right, and center. They have this huge stack to work with, and this should be both those heroes levels. Actually, Bulba's a little bit behind on levels. He's level 3, but pot, I should be fairly close.
Way 2 gets the kill on MSS again, top lane. Quickfa uses his ball lightning, gets a pull, and then back to the camps we go.
That's bad. MSS cannot be in this sort of situation where he's died 3 times in the offlane.
He should have just gone to the jungle, I feel. I mean, I guess you could just hope top goes a bit better after that last TP.
He doesn't know that they have the ward there, so he's expecting that the supports are somewhere else, or that they're jungling, or that they're checking rune, or that they're ganking other lanes, but they always have the best informed decision because he is under the guise of his reward. So, I mean, MSS is just making mistakes that a very well-experienced offlaner wouldn't make.
And that ward, again, Vision is king for mousesports. Once again, giving them so much room to work with, making so much space. Qualifier is going to take, I believe, a trip back home. He comes back through. Meanwhile, Pilot I was taking and stacking up some more camps. He's almost level 6. This is going to be huge. Relocate's going to come out very early. And I think if they have Vision on Ush in the jungle, or if they could somehow find him in the jungle with a Relocate, maybe another hero there as well, stop him from farming and snowballing and taking up those camps as Shadow Fiends often do. I don't know if you want to relocate onto the Bristleback. It might be tough. He is pretty farmed. He's 58 CS. But the threat of the relocate is always the biggest thing, too, as well. So,
I mean, the thing with Mouse is that they're just able to leave heroes alone in lane and just not worry. Like, they have the Shadow Demon farming top. He's not really scared. He's been farming there for, like, maybe a minute and a half. They have Viper, who hasn't had the help of Wisp and is still dominating the Shadow Fiend, 700 net worth gold on top. So, I mean, Gnar just has no pressure coming out. Like, Witch Doctor, Lion, where's the Smoke Gangs? Where are the rotations? They're playing green.
They've rotated mid once. It's done nothing. And since then, it's been all defensive play coming out from support.
It's the same thing as last game, where they need to be playing aggressively. You need to make Mouse reconsider their ganks or, you know, create some space up for MSS so that he can just be in a one-on-one situation versus Storm, which he can get experience in farming. And they're just, I mean, it's important to get your Blink Dagger. It's important to get your levels. But at the same time, they're losing out on too much by playing this sort of style.
Korok down bottom is going to be getting his headdress. And his mech is pretty much done at this point. And that is the one shining beacon coming out from Narvi2. They have one kill. It's 9 minutes in. They aren't too far behind. Ush is getting stacks now in the jungle as we speak. But Black is also getting that mech too. He's got his buckler up. MSS will rotate to the jungle finally. He's going to get boots. He's got his soul ring. And from here, it's about levels and maybe getting a good vacuum wall in the next couple of minutes here as we progress through the mid-game.
But you see all the support play is spilling over to everyone else right now. Like, Darkseer, because of the poor support play, he's died 3 times as well as forced to go to the jungle. And because of that, Shadow Fiend's farm is limited too because he can't fully utilize his jungle. And on top of that, now it's spilling over to Bristleback. So everyone's farm on Narvi2 is just impaired by this lack of support movement, lack of pressure, lack of anything coming out from Lion and Witch Doctor.
And Bulba's almost level 6 as well. He's going to be a nuisance around the map. And we saw how much Pilai Dai can do in a Bounty Hunter. Bulba comes in with Vendetta, sets up a kill as well as a relocate. Like, Bulba's going to Vendetta into the jungle, find one hero, they're going to relocate and they're going to kill him with an Impale. That's pretty much just how it's going to go, honestly, for mousesports. And there's really not much Narvi can do about it. Maybe a good cast, vacuum. Top lane Chad is a little bit too far up. I say that, it's only 10 minutes and he's under his tier 2 tower, but still dies. Quickly gets the kill. Io actually almost went down to the tower, but does not in the end. He gets back home, his relocate's ready to go as well, but he's in the base with no hero to partner up with. Bulba gets a haste rune, still no 6, but he's very close. And again, now it feels as if Gnar, they're forced into this situation. Let's push the tower, let's stay together, let's make sure we find something here. Let's get some gold, let's get some money in our bank. Bulba, he has the Impale. But he's alone. They're actually split pushing mid. They have 2 heroes here, and they're actually putting a lot of pressure on that mid tier 1 tower. Viper's going to work already. Fog with the Witch Doctor actually gets the last hit. He's rich. They're going to keep going for the tier 2 tower into that bottom lane as well. The Impale coming through does only some creep wave damage. Pilot Eye has the spirits up as well. I like the pressure that Narvi are putting on, but they will back away. They don't want to pressure too hard, and their tier 1 tower mid, they're going to have to TP to defend it. Black is ready to go with Viper Strike. Quark's the only one here. Shadow Poison's going to go through. And Korok is forced to back up. They have no way of initiating. There's no hook shot, no blink daggers up just yet. So Black's able to walk away just cleanly, honestly.
Mm-hmm. And Fog, again, waiting for an opportunity to be presented to him. I like him when he has his blink dagger, but I think his play has been a little bit too predictable. And what teams do is they just put so much pressure on him that eventually he has to stop farming, and then they just turn wait for him to just sit there while they farm up themselves. And I think that's kind of what happened this game and last game.
Bulba. Smoke Vendetta, this is what I was talking about. MSS gets relocated on, not really necessary. I think Bulba could have gotten that kill. Solo might have been close, might have not gotten a couple.
He's expecting resistance from NAR.
No, they're not there. They're all mid, man. They get relocated on, they weren't expecting it. And suddenly it's just an easy kill, and MSS is just like, can I at least get levels? Can I at least just live for 5 seconds? Is that possible?
Is that Observer Ward safe on bottom from the sentry?
No, it is not. But they don't have the vision yet to figure out that there's an Observer Ward there. They're still pushing into this mid-tier 1 tower. They're trying to make things happen for an RV2. I like that. But now Koigfa is starting to get a bit farmed. He's top in net worth. What is Koigfa going for? Is he going to go for the early Bloodstone Orchid? It is the Orchid. He's going to be picking that up. Momentarily already has the one Oblivion staff.
If you thought Darkseer was having a bad game, it's going to get even worse when this Orchid comes out.
Oh, man. He's not going to be happy. Quark is going to get a Vitality Booster.
So no Guardians for him.
Yeah, he's just going to go for the Arcanes and the Mech, which is really weird. Because you want Treads on a Bristleback, like 9 times out of 10.
You want Treads if you aren't getting Guardians.
Yeah.
I mean, he's not getting Guardians right now.
But later.
But I think, yeah, Treads Mech would have been maybe a little bit more solid. And again, it's the same game plan as before. It's like, okay, we're behind, we get our mech, and then we push. But now they can't push, just because Storm can just jump on anyone. Lion's not level 6 yet, there's no wall on him. Darkseer has no items. And how is SF faring, at least? He's the highest level in the game. Oh my goodness.
That doesn't look very good.
BKB is important this game, though, but generally people like it as a second or third item, or else you can't farm, you can't make plays, you can't Requiem bomb people, and it really limits what SF can do in a game and how he can take control of the enemy team.
I feel like this is kind of a bait. Koigfa's sitting here. They can relocate in, but they have no vision of the supports behind him, Chad as well as Fog. Now they do with the Remnant flying vision. Chad's going to walk in. Ball lightning away. Chad knows. He takes some damage. And then Koigfa kind of panics and TP's out after using all of his mana. That was kind of funny. But they'll walk back to the jungle. So, yeah, at this point, I wanted to ask you, do you feel like Narvi, this time, last game, are they in a better position than they were then or what?
I mean, they're in a better position now than they were last game because they have a better lineup. They have Bristleback, which can actually do things. They have Counterkink potential on the Wisp. They have the Vacuum Wall as well as the Cask as well as the Requiem and a 2-man Impale. So pretty much all the heroes can do something versus Wisp Relocate. It's still not the best for them. But their net worth is pretty sizable.
They're at least staying even, I'd say.
Yeah, Lion's a big loser here with nowhere close to getting his Blink Dagger.
He is the 5 this game, it looks like. The Witch Doctor even has more farm than him. They will smoke up top, and they're going to try to find a potential pickoff. Quark will be a little bit late to the party because he has to clear out the creep wave. They don't want to make it too obvious. Bulba, Pilot Eye, and Koigfa. They're in the jungle. They can relocate out if necessary. And with no Blink Dagger on Bleak, it's very difficult. They're going to see Pilot Eye in a moment. They need a Hex. They will get it off. They might need an Earth Spike. They're going to get Remnanted on. That was beautiful. They're going to get both of those heroes away. The Earth Spike comes out, but now they have to back away. Black is coming in. He's ready to go. And here's Bulba as well with the Vendetta. They've got the Viper Strike. The Spirits kill Chad alone. Impale misses. There's the Vacuum. No wall coming out. Rather, vice versa. Switch that. It's going to be a mech coming out, though. There's the Death Ward. Bulba getting low. Black walks back through the wall. He does get the mech up as well. Quick from the backside. Looking for MSS. He will find him. Fogged as well. Getting low. He's got the Demonic Purge. He's going to use the, I believe, Salve to keep himself up and alive. Koigfa, he's out of mana, but they do have the Tether. Do they have the Relocate? They do. They're not going to use it, though. Turned into a 2-for-1. That was actually looking a lot better for Gnar, but Koigfa on the backside picking out a couple of heroes in the process, and now they're going to chase a couple heroes down. They decide against it. Narvi will get out with just losing those two heroes in the process.
Pretty good fight. Nice play from Bulba. They could have easily just sacked Pilot Eye and just outfarmed him, but he really didn't want Pilot Eye to die there because they would have probably turned that into a T1 push. So instead, he puts himself at risk by going in, and if he gets in a compromising position, they can just relocate him out. So I really like that play from Koigfa right there, and it bought a lot of time for his team to come in to get help.
Oh, not again. MSS is saying, please, for the love of God, no. He gets relocated on, dies within a second. They'll get the tier 1 tower mid, at least it looks like, but still, another relocate gank. The glyph will come through. Relocate, I think, came from the top lane. I'm not sure, but it's not going to matter. They won't be able to defend this, it looks like. The tier 1 tower is going to take a spill. Korok with the last right click coming through. Way too in black, going to back away. And 16 and a half minutes, still only two kills, though. And it's just right now, Koikva is starting to ball out of control, literally. 7,000 in net worth. Korok's keeping pace with him with that Vanguard now. They'll head top, Pylai die, and that's where he's spotted out. He's got the tether to get away if necessary, and it looks like he's getting back underneath the tier 1 tower. No, he goes into the tree line. Uh-oh. Ush is looking for the kill. Maybe now Pylai die TP's away, and he actually will make it out. Ush knew he was there, but it's a bit too late. Orchid is done for the storm now, and you were talking about how rough MSS is going to have it now. Oh, my God. It's going to be pretty bad for the Darkseer player.
The net worth might be even or close to even, but Maus has a big advantage because of their mobility. They have Nyx who can scout out for good ganks. They have the Whispery Locate as well as the Storm. And their heroes are also just much less likely to die in the fights because of Overcharge and Tether, Relocate, Shadow Demon Disrupt, as well as Viper just being an innately tanky hero. So, I mean, I like the way that Gnar's playing right now. They're certainly playing a lot better than last game. They're taking down objectives. They're working somewhat together as a team. They fared off better in their lanes. They're trying to counterplay Maus a little bit, but at the same time, it's just a little bit too predictable. Like, Bristleback's pushing out really far. Oh, I wonder how many heroes are behind him.
It's four. It is four. Darkseer is not quite there yet. Midas is done for the Viper, so Black goes for the similar item choice that Korok did last game, but he gets it a bit later. Waitsu's trying to push this out with the Shadow Poison. They don't have a creep wave. Viper gets the tier 1 tower mid. It's split push versus split push. Bulba, they have Vendetta. They've got the vision, though, with the Sentry Ward coming out, and Chad was looking to maybe bait him in. Bulba knew this, though. He was very clear on what was happening. He does not want to give himself away. Impale misses. He does blow up the creep wave, though, and now they're making space for Black and Pilot Eye, who can relocate into the fight as the Tier 2 tower is getting pressured mid.
See, Gnar is just too predictable, and they're, you know, five-manning behind Korok. Like, there are different plays, right? They can have Bristle with one hero sitting behind them and then smoke gank the other two with Wisp. And then they can transition that into a tower push. But looks like Koikva.
Oh, Korok, this is the one kill that you can't afford to give up if you're an RB2, and they are going to give it up. The Orca comes out, the Impale as well. They had some great TPs in the tree line. They relocated, in fact, in front of them, I believe. But that is going to be Korok going down. Pylai Dye does fall. It's going to be the Ush Shadowfiend that takes care of him as he comes back mid, I believe. Still, though, losing Korok is a pretty detrimental aspect to that fight.
Oh, yeah, it certainly is. And I mean, they're just responding with five mana in the best possible way. Split push with Wisp. Have a couple of heroes sit back to stall the push so your tower doesn't fall, which was accomplished, and then pick them off as soon as they retreat. So, again, Narvi just have to play much less predictably. Sometimes have Bristleback out alone with no support behind them. Sometimes try and smoke ink and kill the other. Sometimes have like two heroes behind him. Sometimes just farm with the jungle while Bristleback split pushing. And, you know, just vary things up. Try and maximize your efficiency because right now Maus just reads every one of their plays very easily. And they're just going to incrementally increase their lead with Nyx ganks into relocate ganks and then just get huge on Koikva if anyone tries to split push.
This is the play. Is this the play, actually?
This is nice and unpredictable.
But Bulba's going to walk right into the pit. Oh, if he walks into this pit. No, he's going to go to the jungle. He's not going to see anybody is there, but by that time,
Rush
might be dead.
He might see the chicken.
The chicken's flying over. Does he see it? No, it passes over the wrong way. It's actually over the tree line. Roche is going to fall here. This is going to be a big pickup coming out for the side of Gnar V.
That's huge.
And they get the Aegis on Ush as well. And they're looking to maybe pincer move in for mousesports. They decide against it. They say, we can't fight. They're all together. Bulba on the backside. He might be able to get fogged. There's MSS as well. Koikva's looking to jump in. They're going to relocate. MSS in trouble. Fog's going to get silenced as well. They're already fighting now. Down one hero. But a great wall coming through. Koikva in trouble. Has to ball lightning away. The Glimmer Cape comes out as well, which was just picked up for Pylai Dive. Viper Strike in the backside. Chad. We'll see you later. Black now taking the right clicks from Ush. They have the Crimson Guard, but it's a 2v5 engagement. Black's going to back away. Pops the mech, now TPing away. Koikva pulls in on MSS. No vacuum. He's going to go down. They're losing every hero one by one. The Requiem not doing much as well. The Viscous Nizagul, great stun onto two from Bulba. Mousesports are toying with Gnar V. Korok is about to fall as well. The right click and the ball lightning in from Koikva. They're going to deal with Ush last, and he is the Aegis. That is a 5-man wipe, might even be a 6-man wipe with this Aegis going down the Impale. Ush will BKB. He doesn't have a TP. He does get the kill onto Koikva, but 3 heroes for 5 at this point. Maybe if he gets way too, he could turn this around another race. He goes for the short raise. Ush He didn't have the long range raids ready to go. There's going to be the disruption, the soul catcher. He'll clean up some of the illusions. Now jump back in from Koik for the pull in as well. Here's Chad. Earthspike's going to go. Ush, going to try to turn on this. They finger him. They get him. He's down for 64. Big turnaround. That is huge coming up for an RV2. That fight was looking so disastrous, but that last kill might have netted them some huge gold and momentum as well.
I really like that play for spooking the Roshan and then taking a fight. It looks like Mouse was about to outlast them right there, but the BKB turnaround, they clearly didn't expect that BKB. No. Storm didn't have enough mana to zip away.
Did he buy back on the Storm? Doesn't have a Bloodstone. That was an aggressive play from Koikfa. When they were in a really good position, they could have just got out and said, we don't need to get Ush a second time. Then he gives his life away again. Did not expect Bleak to be there with that immediate Hex into the Earth Spike. That's a big kill coming out on the side of an RV2. They have a lifeline here. They've got a pulse, it looks like, for the side of an RV2.
What's Black going for now?
2,300 gold in the bank.
Scepter?
He's saving up money. Aghanim's probably would be the likely candidate or the most popular one. Maybe goes something else, though. S and Y? I don't know. I have no idea.
Actually, they should have known that Shadowfiend had BKB because he went BKB first.
That's right. They should have saw that Ogre Club. They kind of maybe just lost track of it, or they thought it was down after the first fight. But he was getting kited so much.
Yeah, he didn't use it.
Yeah.
I mean, that if they knew they had BKB, they could have just backed out, and then I think it would have been fine. But instead, they lose Storm twice and a buyback money. So that's like a 1,500 gold deficit that could have been avoided by checking one's items.
Now, Ush is three levels ahead of every other hero. But where do they go from here now? What do they have to do to use that kill? Or just do they have to make plays? Do they have to push in again? What do they have to do for an RV2 to...
Again, just make it difficult for Mouse to respond, I would say, is the most important thing to do. And, again, they didn't see the Roche coming. Bulba was right there. He didn't even bother checking. And... Narvi also got some really good wards out right there. They had the real nice high ground ward, which maybe they can control the Ancients, maybe steal a sack or something like that. But, I mean, I think that with that engaged, they're completely caught up. And Darkseer, he has Glimmer Cape now, so they can save Bristleback.
He's like, hallelujah, I am farmed. I have items to work with. I'm not dying anymore.
Yeah, they have. And it's also pretty good versus Nexus Assassin, so he just doesn't die immediately.
By the way, to answer your question about Viper, he's going Aghanim Scepter.
He's going Axe, okay.
Yeah, he has the point booster plus 2k gold, so he's going to have it very soon, which I'm actually a pretty big fan of, especially against Korok in this game. Viper Axe is huge against the Bristleback.
It's also pretty good versus SF.
Mm-hmm. Goes through that BKB. He's going to be pretty nice to have. And that might actually be... We don't talk often about Viper Axe, but that might be the X factor, honestly, in some of these engagements. The Viper Axe going through the BKB and just slowing down these inherently tanky heroes and the frontline heroes, so... All right, that's going to be the choice. Korok is going to be going for what I imagine to be a BKB.
I think Dire needs to keep up pressure with Nyx. They still need to put pressure out with Nyx Assassin Ganks into the relocate, which is what Bulba's doing. And then Radiant side, they just have to get more farm out on Bristle and Shadow Fiend so they can tank through the storm and constantly make them jump and waste mana and just constantly tank up so they don't die to this magic burst, I think. BKB on Bristle. Actually, he has Glimmer Cape. I think he'll be okay because of that.
Wow, that is a double damage rune for Black. They're going to smoke around, but there's only two of them. They do have the relocate, but Bulba is not there. Chad sitting next to his Sentry Ward, but he's in the back lines right now. They don't see Way 2. Do they see Way 2? Do they see him? They scout him out, rather. They're going to search forward. Earthspike misses Chad. That's just a bit too early. Now goes for the Hex up, but they need the follow-up, and they might get... caught in a bad position. Vacuum, blind vacuum, MSS, he gets it off, and Way 2 is going to fall. He'll disruption himself, and now coming in the backside is Bulba. Bulba's looking maybe for an impale, and won't walk too far, and he's afraid of a sentry ward, but Koikfa is going to take down that tier 2 tower top lane. The split push is real, and they might even keep going as well. And now the tier 2 on the other side. Tier 2 for a tier 2, plus a kill in the end. Now they're going to be forced into the Tier 3 tower. They don't have that Aegis anymore. They have a Manta style, though, to do some damage. They're going to actually bring back the Io. And Koikfa should have a TP, I imagine. He's going to buy something from the Secret Shop real quick. No, he does have a TP. He also has 2.8k gold. They clear up the creep wave mid. I don't know about pushing high ground right now. Maybe they just want to force out TPs, but they need to be careful. Viper Strike's going to go through. He has the Aghanim Scepter, obviously, but there's the Glimmer Cape, which is really well done coming out from Bleak, or rather MSS. And they'll back away smartly. That was too early, I think, to go for high ground pressure.
Yeah, Storm just owns those kind of pushes. Just go in, zip on someone, run back home really quickly, TP back, and just zoom in and kill a couple more people. It's really difficult to push into Storm. He's not over-farmed, though, which I think is really important. He's still second on Earth, which is pretty good, but having a not over-farmed Storm is extremely important for Narvi's victory chances.
And the thing is, though, if left unchecked, he will become overfarmed at some point in this game. He's going to get plenty of room to CS, maybe even a couple of kills. They're all rotating top. Koikva has made a little alcove here in the tree line. Ush is going to come in, clear the creep wave. Koikva, I don't think, has vision. He doesn't have a remnant down. I might be wrong about that. They might see him now. They don't. So Koikva will TP out. He's going to head back to the tier 3 tower mid. They'll push out top. They're probably going to go for this tier 2 tower. So methodically, Narvi are going to try to pressure and push down all these outer towers, gain a gold advantage, and then maybe try to take another Roche. And from there, maybe get a pick or two into a win. But that is assuming everything goes well here over the next couple of minutes.
Mouse just has to keep their length pushed out. If they keep their length pushed out, Narvi can't really push that well. And then they can just counter by split pushing with Viper or Storm, which is pretty much what they have been doing. Narvi probably need a gem really soon. Obviously to deal with the Knicks, but also to get the Observer Wards down on the side of Mouse so that they can move around, get some picks, and transition into more towers.
The thing is, though, we talked about the vision advantage that mousesports had last game. It doesn't exist in this game right now. They have no vision, as Pitmuckle is showing, on this side of the map. They have one ward in that middle lane, and that's it. That's all they really have in this game coming out from mousesports. So that's the biggest thing. Narvi can feel more comfortable in their own side of the map. And that's actually giving them a pretty big advantage here. Uh-oh, Koikva. They're control pinging, but not in the right place. Actually, it might have been a Bulba ping. Chad, sitting behind Korok. Korok not seen. The Remnant doesn't scout him out just yet, but if Chad walks forward, which he does, Koikva knows that he's there. And Koikva could probably get an easy pick off if he decided to go for it.
Did he know? I don't know.
He did. It showed the last bit of the vision. He walked up into that Remnant vision.
Well, Nick Assassin, nowhere to be found, so now Narvi can push up with impunity.
Yeah, they're going to go for this tier 2 tower. They're going to feel pretty good about it as well. BKB now done for Korok, and the only real issue, I think, is going to be that acceptor for the Viper and how they deal with that, honestly. I don't know. Right-click's really not an issue, honestly. So and it's really the Viper strike slowing them down and them getting kited.
Yes, getting kited is the biggest problem. But
this is interesting. They're going to push the tier 3. They want to rotate all the heroes from mousesports back. And Bulba's got to take the long road, honestly. They're going to TP a couple of heroes in. Koikva's on the side. I don't know if they saw this or not. Quark's going to back away. Tier 3 tower taking a lot of harass. Now they're going to throw up the Viper Strike. Did Ush dodge that? He did. He manta dodged it. That's not the hardest thing to do against Viper Strike, but still pretty cool to watch every time.
They're wasting a lot of time here.
And they finally TP back. They lose the tier 2 tower top, I think, which was going to go down anyways. I'm not sure if that was the tower that just fell. Could have been the mid one. I'm not sure. It was the mid one, in fact. Tier 2 had already fallen at that point. So towers are even right now, but it doesn't feel even, honestly. It feels as though Narvi are kind of... Net worth graph does indicate that mousesports have a lead in terms of gold, but I don't feel like in momentum-wise they have a lead. I feel like Narvi are making the right plays here, and they're taking the advantages. And they have maybe a solid team fight right now.
They need Roche. Both teams need Roche.
Cask. Koikva is going to get hit up by that, but he does take the DD. That is frightening. That's probably the worst time when Roche... Roche has respawned as well. There's an Alpha Wolf on the Radiant squad to scout this out, but they need a pickoff, or they need to keep the waves pushed in. And even then, they need a pickoff, honestly, to be able to do this Roche, I think.
Well, they can smoke.
You get away with that twice, though?
Probably.
Okay.
Mouse haven't been... I mean, it's only the Knicks that's actively scouting them. Storm's just been power farming.
They are smoked. Are they going to do it? Are they really going in for Roche a second time? This feels almost expected to me, but they could do this pretty quickly. They have the goo. They have the presence of the Dark Lord. Look how fast it's dropping. And mousesports, if they have an idea, they're not rotating quickly enough. It looks like they will start moving over there now. Roche is dead, man. He is donezo. Ush will pick up the Aegis as well, and now you've got to back away. All right, Narvi, another new lease on life here, and they'll try to push into the bottom lane, but top tier 3, getting assaulted by 3 creeps and a range creep. It's not great, but Koikva, now with a newly minted Bloodstone and 1,800 gold as well, he's getting scary to deal with at this point in the game.
Yeah, things are so much different when they don't have a bounty hunter to keep tabs on them.
Did they ban that hero, by the way? I didn't actually see.
I don't remember. I don't think so.
The analysts are like, I don't know. Nobody knows at this point. We didn't talk about it. That was like a big point we made too in the last game, but yeah, that's. I'm gonna assume they did.
Way 2 and Pilot Eye also have very different styles of play. So. Well, here they go. High ground push with the Aegis this time. They were bold enough to do it without the Aegis, and now with it, completely confident they can at least get this tier 3 down.
Do they have the glyph up and ready to go for the side of mousesports? They do not. Tier 3 is going to get melted. And now the Glimmer Cape. Ush walks back in, but there's a Sentry Ward. They do see him. Pilei Dai out in the front line with Black as well. Quark going to turn his back. More Shadow Poison stacks. Ush does have that Aegis, but he needs to be careful. The melee Rack's taking some harass here. Now they're going to jump in. Impale blows up the Aegis. Rack's not dead yet. Vacuum. Wall comes out as well, but there's the ball lighting. The Requiem from us with the BKB on to 3. Bulba not dead yet, though. They want this Rex. They're going to get it. Koifa hasn't gotten a single kill. Death Ward comes out. Goes to Koifa, not doing nearly enough damage. He'll ball lightning away. They take the melee Rex. They just need to get the range Rex as well. They've already come out on top in this fight. They need to back away. They don't need any more. Great initiation. Aegis was expended. BKB. Great wall from MSS making that play. They get a Rax. Did they get the range Rax? I don't believe so. They did. They got the range Rax. They get the set of Rax entirely, Ben. Looking real good right now for an RV.
Mouse had such a good advantage, but with, I mean, I can't believe everything fell apart so quickly after that Roche.
Yeah.
The split push presence isn't enough, and this is where Storm is not that good relative to a lot of the other Wisp partners, and the deficiency is really showing. Because he's getting all the time split push in the world, but he can't take down towers. A CK, a Tiny, anything like that would just be able to destroy those towers in a time that it takes Narvi 2 to group up as 5 and then commit to a push on high ground. But instead, they have a Storm Spirit, really good at killing heroes, but not when they're all 5 bunched up, not when Bristleback went full tank items, and not when SF has BKB and Aegis. So they can't really find a good time and place to kill people.
Koikva is clearly more comfortable on the Storm Spirit, though. That's a hero that he plays very, very often. And you could argue that maybe they didn't feel comfortable with a Tiny this game. But they clearly are, like you said, they're falling behind because of those specific reasons. And MSS now with a Blink Dagger as well. We saw in the last fight, a level 2 wall. There's a Butterfly done for Ush. There's just not that much damage coming up from the Storm Spirit. You want a little bit more, maybe attack speed, just some extra damage. The Scythe would help out a lot because the intelligence gives you. You just need that extra item or maybe even more Bloodstone charges. And he's really not there. I think he still might be at 8 charges on that Storm Spirit. In fact, he is. He's smoked up, wrapping behind. They don't have all their team. Io looks like he might relocate in with the rest of the squad. Way 2 sitting in the back lines. There's MSS as well. They know. They're getting relocated on with Fog. He's going to get silenced up. Glimmer Cape comes through. Beautiful double impale. They get the mech off. Requiem going to go through. They don't blow any hero up just yet. Now, Vacuum comes in again. On to 4. The wall as well. The Death Ward popping through. Koikva getting low. They'll bring down one as Pilei die. Koikva not dead yet. Vendetta comes through. Another impale. TP out. They lose 2 with support for support at this point. Koikva TPing away. He'll make it out in time. But still, another great vacuum wall. They do take the fight outside of the base, and that's, I think, the most important thing for mousesports here.
Yeah, but they don't win a fight, and Narvi 2 don't have Aegis. So, like, this is really bad for Mouse. They had a window. They blew it by letting them sneak in Roche, and...
Well, that's a good ball lightning coming in. Ush doesn't have his BKB. He's got to have that Mantis. Another great vacuum coming through. Ush now getting Glimmer Caped. And there's the Guardian Greaves as well. Koikva getting destroyed. The cast bouncing through. Has to buy back. Black's going to go down, but he doesn't have buyback. Koikva ball lightnings. And they will get the kill onto Ush. He's down for 76. Tier 3 tower did survive, I believe. There's the mana burn. Now Korok going to turn around. He says, I can take this fight. I've got that BKB. Nope, that's not ready. It's not for 60 seconds. Pull into Fog. Voodoo Restoration keeping him alive. Vendetta's going to go. They finally bring him down, but they also bring down another hero. I believe it's Pilei Dai. Koikva running low on mana. Korok just needs another right click. There's going to be the Crimson Guard keeping MSS alive, but only for a moment longer. Korok with the blade mill coming through. Now the jump in. The finger from Chad finds the kill onto Bulba. Way 2 trying to make it out as well. It forces away. Somehow, they do get Koikva out alive. But that fight still, I think, favors Narvi 2 in the end as well.
Man, poor Storm Spirit. With another buyback. He's had 2 buybacks this game. And again, as you mentioned before, they don't have that many disables to actually kill him. But he just can't kill anyone because... SF and Bristle are so tanky.
Yeah. That's been the biggest thing, and it's always something I'm surprised by is how actually inherently tanky Shadow Fiend is with just BKB. It's not like he's a Scotty yet. He doesn't have an SNY. This is just an inherently tanky ranged hero. And Korok, of course, is not invulnerable, but they aren't focusing him down, which I think is the right choice in a lot of these engagements. Pick off the supports first, but you have Guardian Greaves, you have Voodoo Restoration, you have Glimmer Cape. How are you supposed to kill these heroes on the side of Narvi 2? They're struggling just to kill supports, honestly.
Well, you have Crimson Guard.
And that as well, yeah, you're right.
Wait, do they have, yeah, they have
they Crimson. Do, yeah, they do. It's on MSS, I believe. Oh, no, it's on Perspec, sorry.
I mean, Bristle sitting at 27 armor, and then that's a lot. And then he has, as you mentioned, Crimson Guard as well as BKB. So it looks like he's going for Octarine Core next. And I mean,
Octarine Core Bristleback. We played against that. All right, never mind. Sorry. I'm just remembering.
It's looking really bad for Mouse right now. And they either need to split push aggressively or they need to get kills. But to get kills, they need to scout out with Nyx, and Narvi 2 has to be split up. And Bulba always has to fear Narvi 2 picking up a gem, getting a free kill on him, and then proceeding to high ground. So he can't really scout them out right now. And, I mean, he's trying to in the very far back, but it's just not an easy life for Bulba.
He has the point booster, and the Octarine Core on Nyx Assassin has been so good recently. I also I saw my first Aghanim Scepter on, it was the other day. I think Moonmi underplayed it, actually, yesterday.
That thing's own it.
Yeah, it's really good. That long, that stun, do you see the length of that stun? It's actually ridiculous. Plus the 40% reduced damage that you take as well, I believe. Mm-hmm. And you're invisible and whatever, but Lurker. Sick. But it's probably going to be an Octarine Core first because the mana burn is like 3 second cooldown. And it's so good. You just spam out the mana burn. I don't know how good it is this game, but maybe he does go Aghanim Scepter. I don't know. He might not even be able to complete another item here with the way the game is going. Pimmuckle thinks it's Aghanim Scepter. He's hovering over it. And he's shaking his head yes. You're such a cheeky observer, you know. You really are. Stop. Stop. There's the Viper Strike. Actually gets canceled from Black. The Tier 3 tower is getting assaulted, and it's gone. And now they're going to go to work on the melee racks. And now the BKBs just get popped, and they're going to run in. Requiem? It does do some of the reduction there. Pilot Eye in the wall. There's the vacuum as well. Korok runs in. Koikva now goes in the backside. Blink Impale onto 2 with Ush. Ush now, Crimson Guard's up and ready to go. Getting kind of low. Getting kited around. Ush getting low. Still alive, though. The Voodoo Restoration, as well as the Guardian Greaves, the Crimson Guard, and they will get Koikva. The Death Ward comes out. Fog gets the double kill. Bulba comes in triple Impale. But is it really going to matter? The racks are going to go down. Bulba is now going to get caught out. Chad's going to see him. He does get the Earth Spike off. The Hex is going to come in just a moment, and Bulba will fall as well. He's got buyback, but it looks like game number 2 is going to be heading to Narvi 2. That will be the GG call, and we're headed to game 3, guys. Whew.
Overall, I think pretty sick draft from Narvi. Given their limited time, it was actually a very impressive draft, and the Roshan was just so important.
Smoke Rosh.
I still expect more plays out of their supports. I think their support play is just really weak in the first 10 minutes. They wouldn't be forced into these positions where they had to smoke if it weren't. But since they were in that behind position, they smoked Gank Roche twice, and that was just game-changing.
I can't believe it worked the second time. I was actually saying, I was like, that should be expected. Mm-hmm. They knew the Roche timer was coming up, and they rotated. It looked like they were rotating over there. They were trying to figure it out, but it didn't they couldn't get there in time. And so a second Roche, and after that, it kind of all went downhill from there. But enough about us. We're going to bring in Hani as well as Purge. Guys, you guys were watching the game right alongside with us. Any thoughts about the game? Hani, we'll start with you this time.
I think generally the number one thing that stands out to me with Gnar is they moved as a team. They got the mech very early, and then they just went from tower to tower. And we haven't seen that in their last previous games at all. They did not move as a team. There was no team effort whatsoever. So I really enjoyed seeing that from Gnar coming back into this game. I think it was a wake-up call, pretty much. They had to perform here. The other big factor in that second game is I think Mouse actually were on top of this game. I think they played solid. And the one thing that just happened is Koiko's death. When they try to go for Ush, he dies once. On the BKB call, right? He gets the BKB off. He dies. Then he buys back. He tries to get the counter kill. Unlucky. Did not manage to do so. But from there, the game just went downhill for Mouse.
I feel like that was the turning point. You're absolutely right. That buyback into death, the dieback coming through from Quakefa. Any other glaring issues you saw with mousesports, Purge, or was it all Narvi in that game?
I mean, that the buyback death definitely held it together. He wasn't expecting Chad to be there, but I think the first smoke roche was really huge. It basically put mousesports, the entire game they avoided fights, essentially. They looked for ganks the whole time. I mean, even Quakefa especially was sitting on side lanes behind trees. They were looking to get ganks off, but Gnar was sitting behind their cores a lot. Another thing I really liked about what Gnar did that game is their itemization was very different. I mean, have you ever seen a Bristleback that has those items? It's like the weirdest assortment of stuff. But I really like the Arcane Boots in the early game because against a Nyx Assassin, if Nyx Assassin mana burns you, your mana pool goes pretty low.
Yep.
Your way to sustain mana on Bristle, it's very important because otherwise you're just a weak melee hero. You need the quills and the goo to be able to guarantee that you can solo zone that offlane hero. So by getting the Arcane Boots, it allowed his supports to go do other things. They maybe didn't get a whole lot out of that, but I thought it was necessary for him to do that. And I also love that he didn't just rush Guardian Greaves like he did some of the other games. If he did that, his HP would have been low. He went Vitality Booster immediately after the mech Arcanes, which is what you have to do. Like, Guardian Greaves is based on a percentage, is it not? So if you have more total HP, that means that the reason you buy the item, which is that small 10% tons of armor factor, is a little elongated. So I think that's the best way to do Guardian Greaves. Guardian Greaves, or right before Guardian Greaves, get an HP item, and then maybe you can go back and finish it if you want.
Mm-hmm. Well, let's talk about MVP that game. I know it's hard to choose from a specific assortment of Narvi players or even Mouse players, but do you have one in that you favor over all the other ones?
I would go for Ush that game. He played basically the old school way to play Shadow Fiend. You get a mech and then you get DPS items like Manta, Butterfly, into the Satanic.
Yes.
The only other team that has really played that style that I've seen recently is usually IG with Ferrari. Usually plays that style, but very other teams do. Very few other teams. You usually see mech, Yules, stuff like that. But I really like the build he did. It was very tanky. It has lots of DPS. It's better at dealing with Storm, I feel, because you're just right-clicking him. You don't have anything at stake. You don't have to catch him with the Yules combo. Mm-hmm. You just right-click. And it builds so much better into Satanic, which makes you extra survivable. It's like a much later game build, I feel, than the mech or Yules build. So I think them going that build was very crucial. I'm glad he did that over going a Yules, which I was at the time thinking, maybe Yules would have been better. But mm-hmm. I think it turned out nice.
Do you have a specific MVP, Hani, for that game? Is it Ush alongside Purge here?
It's hard to say. I think it was more of a team effort than mm-hmm. anything. I felt like
whoever called the smoke into Roche.
Yeah.
Pretty much.
MVP.
Yeah. But overall, I think it's a good team performance. I would like to see a third game where both are at their peak. And hopefully, yeah, going into game number 3.
Yeah.
Yeah. What do you think about the it was like a Nyx pick into a lion into a storm? I thought the storm was like a little out of place in that particular draft.
I was talking to Perch about the storm pick. To me, Wisp Storm is the best combo. I like Wisp Storm a lot as a combo in comparison to Wisp Tiny, because I think you're just limited. I think it just goes down to the momentum of Koiko, because he was on top of net worth and then he was completely stomped with that buyback into his second death.
Yeah, honestly, that dieback actually was pretty detrimental. We are going to be jumping into that third game. I believe we might actually already be into it. We will take a quick, like, 30-second, 45-second break real quick, guys, and then we'll jump into the draft in just a second. Stick around. We'll be right back.